Our next presenter, Dr. John Byabagambi, is a Senior Improvement Advisor at USC in Uganda. He has led the USC Assist Project work in applying CQI to VMMC in Uganda. You heard Donna mention the pilot of CQI that was done in Uganda that was led by John. John is not here to present us about that pilot, but he is going to present us what is the experience in Uganda in addressing an other assist project in other countries in addressing key issues the VMMC program faced related to management of adverse events, linkages of HIV positive clients to care and treatment, and also tetanus risk mitigation. Thank you very much, John.
Thank you, Emmanuel. Good morning, everyone. Good afternoon. Like Emmanuel said, I'm going to be presenting about the hot quality topics in VMMC, adverse events, linkages to care, and tetanus risk mitigation. Just about 1 year ago, I presented in a webinar like this on how we in the Assist Project have been working with ministries of health and PEPFAR implementing partners to introduce CQI in the VMMC programs. We began that work in Uganda in 2013 and later on spread to South Africa in 2014 and Malawi and Tanzania in 2015. Since then, as you've heard from Donna's presentation, we have seen a real growth in the number of countries and sites that are actively engaged in applying continuous quality improvement approaches in the VMMC program. And a lot of progress has been made, and sites are getting better understanding of the quality issues and how to address them. As we have seen, the sites have made significant improvements in many aspects of the VMMC service. So today I want to focus on some of the more challenging quality issues that we are seeing and share some of our experiences we've so far registered to date. I'm going to focus on three main issues: management of adverse events, linkage to other services, especially HIV positive clients, HIV care and treatment, and mitigating the risk of tetanus. In what I'm going to present, I'll draw heavily on my own experience in Uganda, as well as that of my colleagues in South Africa. But we feel our experience in these countries is highly relevant to other countries as well. So as you may be aware, VMMC is a preventive surgical intervention, and it's therefore important that we minimize related adverse events that may arise out of that. High rates of adverse events and poor management greatly affect their uptake. Generally, what we've observed is that most men take time to think about the procedure, to have it. And one of the reasons that makes them take long is the fear of adverse events, especially pain. So it is important that we offer a service that minimizes adverse events, and whenever they occur, they are well managed. But generally, there's lack of enough information at country level to tell us about the true prevalence of these adverse events. And this makes it hard for us to implement interventions to prevent them and minimize them. So in 2012, we had an interagency external quality assessment in Uganda. And this assessment brought to light a lot of issues related to adverse events that we were not aware before. Among it, which we had no AE summaries and action plans at facilities. Most sites had no post-male circumcision adverse events documented. And whenever the adverse events were documented, they were never graded. We didn't know how many were mild, how many were moderate, and how many were severe. And some sites lacked the necessary equipment and supplies for management and prevention of adverse events. So we also noted that the service providers lacked knowledge and skills in the management of adverse events whenever they occurred. So what did we do as a country? we embarked on a process of conducting a root cause analysis to understand why we're having this adverse event. And we later found out that it was mainly related with failure to understand the magnitude of the problem. We didn't know how many adverse events we were getting, the rate and the type, and there was also underreporting of these adverse events, and this was mainly because the implementing partners and the sites had fear that if they report these adverse events, then most likely they are going to be penalized, their funding might be reduced or even stopped altogether. We also lacked standardized reporting tools as a country, and because we didn't have these tools, it made it difficult for us to have this information at national level for us to be able to know the magnitude of the problem. And also at site level, teams thought that managing the adverse events was the most important and not reporting the adverse events. So what we did, we supported teams and trained them in the use of the CQI approach to be able to prevent the adverse events. And with the leadership of Ministry of Health and other implementing partners, we embarked on a process of developing client collection information tools which would capture adverse events. We distributed these tools and mentored teams on use of these tools. The picture on the left shows is taken from the VMMC Theater Register in Uganda, and it shows us how we have a section that captures adverse events. It is divided into two, those that happen during the procedure and those that happen after the procedure. And we also capture the grade. We only report the moderate and the severe because this is a surgical procedure. We don't report the mild. The mild is bound to occur. And at the bottom, we also capture the type of adverse event, and we put guidance in this register to make it easy for the service providers to know what type of adverse events to expect. As you can see, during surgery, we expect pain, excessive bleeding, anesthetic related, are some of the examples. We also capture the grade, and we have two types, moderate or severe, and also the action that is taken, whether it is managed locally or it is referred. We want to know how many of these adverse events that occur at a site are managed at that site or how many require referral. On the right side is an adverse events grading scale. We found that the service providers had difficulty in grading the adverse events. For example, pain, how do you tell it is severe? How do you tell it is moderate or it is mild? Bleeding, how do you tell it is severe? How do you tell it is moderate? So that is an adverse events grading scale that helps the service providers to grade the adverse events. So what are some of the changes that we've put in place to minimize the adverse events? One was to conduct orientation of VMMC teams on the grading of adverse events. Some sites were grading everything as mild so that they don't report anything. Others were overgrading, and that can also cause a problem. The other change is holding weekly review meetings to review the adverse events that occurred, learn from them, know. For example, it is important for a team to know why are they getting many clients with infections after the procedure. Is it because of the contamination? Is it happening during the procedure? Is it happening after the procedure? Such information is important for the team to implement interventions to prevent similar adverse events. Cross-checking the client's understanding is very important. When we give information to the clients, it is important that we ask them to repeat the information that we've given them so that we are sure that they've understood, because if they don't understand how to care to look after the wounds after the procedure, in most cases they are going to contaminate the wounds, and this will lead to adverse events. It is also important to know that they understand how to quickly recognize that their they are getting adverse events so that they can come back to the health unit as soon as possible to get help. We also inform clients during mobilizations to come with tight-fitting pants. This mainly helps in preventing hematomas after the procedure. Reinforcing messages on wound care during follow-up. Previously, this message was only given once at the time of the procedure, but whenever the clients come back for follow-up, this information is re-emphasized so that they can keep remembering how to care for the wounds. The other significant change has been emphasizing the need for parents and guardians of minors to attend education sessions. We noted that parents would come to the health unit just to sign a form and then they go away and they leave the minor to attend the education sessions on their own. And we found that in most cases, the minors didn't understand the information we were giving them, or if they understood, whenever they would reach home, they would be in conflict with their guardians and parents. For example, would tell the minor not to put anything on the wound, and then when they reach home, the parent is saying, you must put something, you must put salt, you must put cow dung for quick healing. So it is important that these guardians, they come to the health unit, sit in the health education sessions with the minors, and stay for the entire period of the procedure so that they pick this information on behalf of the minor, and they are able to support the minor after they leave the clinic. The other change we've noted is that improving follow-up is very important in terms of minimizing the moderate and severe forms of adverse events. So, what results have we seen so far? This graph in red is a line graph that shows the rate of adverse events from November 2012, that was baseline, to March 2016. What we found at baseline around November, December 2012 is that the rate of adverse events was generally low. This is what was reported. It doesn't mean that there were no adverse events, but because the teams were not reporting the adverse events, we could only capture this information. So when we took the team through the process of appreciating the importance of knowing the magnitude of the adverse events, the rate went up to as high as 2.5%. Then we started supporting the teams to put in place measures to prevent the adverse events, and as we can see from the graph, the rate went down and has generally been below 1%. But we still believe there is still gross underreporting. We don't think this is the actual picture in the country because, as we might know from the clinical trials, they reported a rate of as high as 3.6%. And we know that clinical trials, they are better organized, they have better facilities, there's better follow-up of all the clients. So in a public health setting like we are working in, a rate of 2.5 as a maximum may not be a true picture, but at least we now have some information which is able to tell us the magnitude of this problem. And from this graph in blue, as you can see, is the rate the percentage of clients who come back for follow-up after the procedure, and we see that at the start of the support, the follow-up rate was very poor and has gradually improved over time to almost close 100% within the first 2 days. And from this graph, we can see that as the rate of follow-up improves, the rate of adverse events goes down. And this is the important message that we've picked. If you want to minimize adverse events, then you have to improve your follow-up rate because you are able to pick the adverse events at a mild state, manage them, and thus prevent the moderate and the severe adverse events. As I mentioned, we only report the moderate and the severe adverse events. So from the previous graph, you saw that the maximum we've seen was 2.5%, but across different sites, we see different pictures. In this, at this site, we see that they had a rate as high as 25%. When they started their program in 2014, but at that time we had already picked important lessons from other sites. That was almost a year after we had begun our interventions. So we quickly supported this team to put in place interventions. Mainly it was issues related with the way they were conducting their counseling. It was not targeted. There was no clear information. The service providers were not giving consistent information. The one who conducts the group education is saying something else. During the procedure, the circumcisers are saying something different. Postoperative nurse is saying something different. So it was all about organizing the message on wound care and prevention of adverse events to ensure that it is consistent throughout the entire process. And as we can see, the team was able to quickly bring down the rate and keep it below 1%. And again, we see that as their follow-up improved, their rate of adverse events also went down. So, as I had earlier on said, we pick information on the type of adverse event. That information is very important because it helps you to implement targeted interventions. If you get to know, for example, that the commonest adverse event at your health unit is infection, then you are able to think through with the team, what interventions can we implement to minimize infection? Is it coming from the clinic? Is it happening after the procedure, after the client has left the health unit? Such information is important because if it is happening after the client has left the clinic, then it means interventions will be around educating the client on how to care for the wound. If it is happening during the procedure, then interventions are going to focus on infection prevention, mainly by the service providers. So it is important for us to know the type of adverse events that we commonly get. And from this chart, we see that the commonest is infection, followed by hematomas, excessive bleeding, pain, and then the other adverse events. So it is very important that teams get to know the type and the grade of the adverse events. So what are some of the key steps we've taken in addressing adverse events? We emphasize that sites should make sure that they realize that adverse events can happen to any team, regardless of the skill. So they shouldn't fear to report adverse event. Even the best surgeon can get an adverse event. If a client has a bleeding disorder, definitely they will get excessive bleeding, either it will be moderate or severe. So having an adverse event does not necessarily mean that the service provider is bad, but they are bound to happen. So what we share with the service providers is that don't fear to report the adverse events. Tell us the type of adverse events you're having, their magnitude, and then we shall be able to provide better support to you. We also note that putting in place a clear grading system and having tools enables systematic and standardized identification and reporting of adverse events. And this helps us to plan at a higher level for the teams, for example, to know whether we need to conduct a refresher training for all the teams in the management of adverse events, or whether we need to get supplies related to the prevention and the management of adverse events. Improving client counseling on adverse events should start during mobilization. In most cases, we tend to leave it at the time of postoperative care. But as we've seen, that is late. For example, if you have minors, you need to inform the parents to come along. If you're having a problem of hematomas, you need to inform the clients to come with tight-fitting pants. So this information should start from the time of mobilization until the client goes through the entire process and including the follow-up visits. It is also important to improve follow-up, as we've seen, to prevent the severe forms of adverse events. You have to manage better the mild adverse events, and this starts by having clients come back to your clinic for review within 2 days and 7 days after the procedure. Also important to analyze the type and the grade and also to institute better systems for their management.